Hey, welcome back. It's Chris from the Mighty Decibel. We're going to have a special edition here again. We've got the Thrash panel back. So we've got Mark and Ian from Electrocutioner.
Cheers.
What's up, guys? How's nice to be back. Chris, thanks for having us.
Right on. And Julian from Krypt.
Hey, how's it going? What's up?
And Leo from Karabiner is going to join us. Hopefully, he'll join us in progress. The last time we got together, the Thrash panel, we looked at the best albums from the best Thrash albums from the 1990s. This episode, we're going to be looking at the best Thrash albums from the 2010s. The way we did it last time, we followed the same process here where I asked each of the three bands to give me, their top 10s. We assigned 10 points for a first place, 9 points for the second place, and so on. Compiled the results, and we have our top 10. They haven't been, the guests here don't know the results, so it's going to be news to them. And we'll go from 10 down to 1, and I'll ask the people who voted for the each of these albums to talk to it, but then we'll leave it open for anybody to join in. Another side note is that, Mark, these votes were from you, from your perspective, and Ian's joining us, but wasn't part of the selection process, right?
Yeah, I felt bad last time as, we're in the same band, so we listen to the same stuff, so we kind of got, like, an extra vote, so I felt bad that, Julian and Leo's picks, and even your picks, may have gotten a little watered down. So this is just me. Ian's listened to them, so it should be more of a representative list here.
Okay. And Ian, jump in whenever you want to if you have any insights into any of these albums.
Of course.
All right.
Yeah, so I'm here. Thanks, man. I appreciate it.
All right. So before we begin, those who have watched the 90s episode, and if you haven't, please check it out, may remember that we had 7 albums of 39 where there was overlapping votes. So pretty wide variety of albums that were picked. Actually, this episode is even worse. There's only 2 albums that were multiple votes. So, yeah, I was incredulous too. I kept on getting your votes and going, no overlap, no overlap, no overlap. So the 2 albums that we did get overlaps both made the top 10, obviously. but we'll get to that.
Wow.
So because of the lack of overlap, you're going to see a lot of ties, obviously, right, in this list. And so much so that at number 10, we have 4 albums tied at number 10. So we're going to be talking about 13 albums, guys, rather than 10 because of the tie at 10th. So let's get right into it. And so obviously these next 4 are the 3rd picks for each of us. Why don't we start with you, Julian, with At the Walls by Enforced.
Oh yeah, this record easily made my top 10. I mean, Richmond, Virginia's had so many good bands come out of it. I mean, you've got like Municipal Waste, Guar, Lamb of God, like a lot of their earlier stuff I'm into, but like Enforced has that mix of like, they're definitely a thrash band, but you can hear a lot of that like hardcore influence on it. And every song from like Born Lost to Retaliation, all those songs, like it kind of pounds in your head, and it's one of those memorable records of the 2010s, I would say, because their sound already sounds so refined, and they have a little bit of that uniqueness to it that a lot of other thrash bands, at least now, they don't really have as much. So I think they definitely like bring a lot of it, because I'm being a music nerd and stuff like that, I do a lot of research from the members and stuff like that, and like a lot of the members have been in other bands that aren't thrash or even like aren't even metal. Like one of the guitar players is in like a hardcore band for a while, and I know one of the other guitar players was in Red Death before they broke up, so like they've done a lot of like good stuff, and especially their new record that came out this year, Killgrid. But I definitely have to say At the Walls is one of my favorite records to come out in the 2010s, and I've been listening to on repeat recently.
Yeah, I like their first, well, that was an EP, right? Yeah, I like that album more than the Killgrid for some reason. It just hit me more. I actually saw them live on tour as well. They were opening, I forget who they were opening for. But anyway, yeah, they were really, really good live on stage as well. And I always consider them more of a crossover type band in my mind when I listen to them, but you can hear the influences that you said from thrash and the hardcore side. Yeah, cool. All right, so then the second number 10 album was actually from Leo, who's not here, but we'll chat about it anyway. It's Time Is Up by Havoc. This is from 2011. So when I think of this one myself, you know, I think of this as, even though it's American thrash with, you know, shout vocals. To me, it's heavily riff based with really good guitar work, which always leads me to think of Exodus. You know, I always tie them together. So you guys have any, you know, input into the Havoc album?
Yeah, I checked out Havoc too. It was close on my list to put in the top 10. I think they have a few albums, obviously, from this decade. I know a lot of people like the record. I think, Chris, you kind of nailed it for me. Like, I like thrash a little less riff oriented. It definitely seems like modern thrash, but they get a lot of love. I couldn't speak too much about, you know, their catalog and, you know, where they've been and where they're going, but it's pretty solid stuff, you know.
Okay. So the third of our number 10s of the 10th ranked albums, actually, I'll talk about mine for a minute. It's Nuclear Revenge with Let the Tyrants Rise. So this is a Spanish group, their debut. Musically speaking, it's definitely a nod towards Teutonic thrash from the 80s. So whereas, you know, Sodom, Creator, and Destruction have slowly, or not so slowly, left their, you know, their early, really hard leanings to the side. This is where Nuclear Revenge steps up and said, hey, if you're leaving that space, I'm taking it. So if you're into that early Sodom, Creator, Destruction stuff, you're going to like this one. So it's, you know, no-nonsense, kick-ass black thrash. And the song I'd suggest you check out would be Ancient Rites. That'll give you an idea of what this band's all about if you haven't heard them. All right, so then the last of our number 10s is for you, Mark and Ian. It's Gods of Violence by Creator.
Yeah, so Chris, I remember last time you were heavy on the Creator, and I was expecting this was going to rank higher.
I don't like your new stuff.
Yeah, well,
yeah, it's kind of what I felt too.
I told Ian, so like Ian didn't know my list. It's interesting because this album is—it's not like my really style that I enjoy, but I actually really admire the album in the sense it's extremely cohesive. I think Ian noticed it too. They put that that Swedish vibe to it in the guitars,
yeah,
and the vocals. I think the songwriting is really good. I guess. Chris, I don't know if you want to chime in on like what you don't prefer about it, but I think the choruses may be a little too like, they're like radio thrash choruses, I guess. They're very bombastic and maybe too clean and polished. Ian, you want to talk about
it? Yeah, I mean, when I listened to it, I didn't even think that it was like a Creator album. It felt more I was listening to like At the Gates or Amon Amarth. You know, I read their kind of like Gothenburg kind of sound to it. Or like melodic death kind of feel to it, especially like the production wise with the way the guitars sound. They kind of have like that kind of fat and heavy, where I think of thrash as more like, you know, it, like you said, it should be like riff based, but the picking is like, it's not, to me, it's not like thrash. Thrash more has like a gallop to it in a sense, as opposed to like, you know, like a more melodic sound.
Well, I think it's a solid album overall, like in the sense that it, sometimes when I was going through a lot of these albums to rank them, they don't actually sound like albums in the sense that kind of they lose a certain cohesiveness where it's like song to song to song and maybe there's no thematic elements. I think the check out the song Satan Is Real or Totalitarian Terror. I think the vocals are really good. I think guitars are very tasteful. But Chris, I'm surprised you didn't rank it, man.
Yeah. Well, I like his voice. Obviously, his voice hasn't changed, right? He's still Italian.
Yeah, it's very really aggressive and demonic.
It's the guitar work. It's too melodic. It's like,
yeah, it's
way around and you're singing, well, that's nice, it sounds nice, but you know, I want rawness and there is no rawness.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, like, if it wasn't a Creator album, I'd be like, wow, this is a really good album, I like it. But when you think it is in the name of Creator, like, it's like, oh well, it's not them, you know. Like,
really, actually that's a good point, because if it was somebody else, I'd probably like it more. But now,
we'll see, Chris.
I picked up their albums in the 80s when they came out. I've been a fan for life, right, of theirs. So I always compare it to their early stuff, and it just doesn't compare. And I,
well, maybe that's why I enjoy it more, because I'm not so familiar with, you know, I'm not a diehard creative guy. Like, I love Extreme Aggression and stuff, and I actually don't enjoy some of the albums that people do enjoy a lot more from creators. So maybe because I'm kind of like a, you know, I'm kind of got fresh eyes on creator, I like it a little bit more. But Chris, you're kind of saying like, I don't like the way this is going, you know?
Yeah. I want to go back. Right. Interesting. So the next one, we're getting into the, we're skipping from number 10 to number 5, because we have 5 albums now tied at number 5 with 9 points. And the first album we're going to be talking about is one of the two albums that has actually 2 overlapping votes. And that's between Leo and myself. It's Vector with Terminal Redux. So the reason, I said last episode that I'm not a big tech prog thrash guy. I was surprised that this album actually resonated with me. But when I think back on it, I think the reason why it did with me is that in the riffing, I heard early Voivod, and I'm a huge Voivod fan. So the dissonant riffing on this, drew me to it and then forced me to listen to it. And of course, I had my head blown off because of how technical it is and how well they fucking played. It's just, I'm usually not into it, but wow, you know, you're just sitting there going, how the hell do they keep this up? Imagine doing this on tour for hour and a half every night for 3 weeks or whatever. Fucking crazy. Anyway, the song that I would suggest for those who haven't heard it would be Cygnus Terminal. Was the one that got me initially into it. What do you guys have any thoughts on Vector?
Yeah, Joey and I don't want to step on your toes. So, Chris, here's my thing. I like Vector. They are, I remember we talked about last time, me and Ian's thrash picks were kind of that, even though we're really not like tech prog guys, they more, so Vector obviously is tech progressive thrash on steroids, to the point where look, they have two albums. I don't know if Black Future's in the same decade or not, but I wanted to like it so bad, but I have really just a hard time calling it thrash because there's just so many elements in it. You know, the vocals are kind of have black metal inspiration, and there might be 4 minutes of a 7-minute song where you can't even, like, where is the thrash? So I'm not hating on them, because I think Vector, in the last 20 years of like a metal band, they've innovated thrash metal and these genres to the point where it really is awe-inspiring. I mean, each album, each song, it's just incredible, like you said, what they do. You know, it's not hook chorus, verse chorus. It's, you know, wild and, you know, that kind of sci-fi, like kind of Voivod, like that outer space feel. I just didn't rank it because I actually had it on my list at number 5, actually, too. And I had to take it off. I was like, you know, it's not pure enough thrash. But how do you feel about that? Was that the wrong decision, Chris?
Hey, everybody has their own votes, right? I put it in as number 5 on my list, and Leo put it as number 6. So it wasn't on the top of our list.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I would say, as we spoke before, and Ian mentioned it, it's not a problem, but we're in 2010 to 2019. This is 30 years after thrash. So to find a thrash metal band that's not incorporating death metal, black metal, progressive, it was nearly impossible. So when I ranked, I tried to look like that, but if you guys are considering Vector like a thrash band, it would be in like the top 5 of their releases, because they're really just so innovative and impressive.
What are your thoughts? Have you listened to Krypt, Julian?
I never really got like super into it. Like, I definitely need to check it out again, just because it's been a while since I've listened to Vector. But I don't know, a lot of the like insanely tech stuff like was never like super big with me. Like, if I'm going more of a tech route, it'd probably be like more death metal than thrash, because I feel like thrash just has a little bit more of a rawness to it. But I'm definitely like gonna check it out again, because I mean, the probably one of my more favorite like tech thrash bands kind of would be Forbidden, just because a lot of the riffage on there, like from their first record and their second record, is like hallmarks of like, I guess, just like technical progression. It kind of shows that a lot of thrash bands can have like the complex riffing without like being too crazy, and the vocal style kind of fit really well with it. But I definitely need to check Vector out again, because I never really gave it too much of a thought after the first time I listened to him.
Yeah, Forbidden were obviously pioneers of that, right? They were one of the first to do that. But all right. So our second of our number nine albums, back to you, Mark and Ian, was Ironbound by Overkill.
All right, Ironbound. I love Overkill. Maybe it's because we're East Coast guys. I got to see how Ian's going to chime in on this one. I don't know if he liked it too much.
It's okay.
I love Overkill. I thought this album, this is like, I think they had two or three albums during this decade. This was their like return to form for me, in the sense that they got rid of a lot of that like blues-based riffing they would do. I think like the first five songs are just pure rippers. No, Overkill's not into this intellectual type metal where, you know, as opposed to Creator, they're talking about the gods and totalitarianism. This is just about kicking ass. Bobby Blitz's vocals are goddamn impressive. I mean, this was their 15th album. I think it's probably his best vocal performance. I would check out the first four songs in a row, just kick ass. But there's a song called Endless War on there, which out of nowhere has like this Iron Maiden, you know, twin guitar attack, which is weird for Overkill, but it's an amazing album. I think
funny that you said that, because that's actually what I felt like you guys were saying with the prog stuff. Like, for me, I felt for this album, there was too much, there was not as much thrash as there was more of this kind of melodic sound to it, right? And so, I mean, like, I think actually one of the first things that came to mind for me was like, you know, what's that kind of juxtaposition, right? Where it's like, you'd have these really heavy riffs, but then you'd also have like these really heavy melodic parts. And I'm like, well, it's not bad, but it's like, it's just, it, for me, again, like, you know, not growing up necessarily, but listening to all the old albums and stuff and comparing it to the stuff now, it's such a stark contrast to me. You know, especially when I went back and listened, I'm like, this is Overkill? Like, again, maybe I would have been like, oh, this is really, it's great in its own sense, but as an Overkill album, it's just
I think it goes back to the idea, like, you know, I guess because I'm a bigger Overkill fan, like I'm aware of what they've been doing since like 1997. So, you know, if you haven't heard an album since, you know, like Years of Decay or something like that, or you know, even Feel the Fire, if like, you just know that and you don't know how they've progressed, you might be like, wow, what is this? But I'm a big fan of that album. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm Overkill's weird one with me in that I have two albums that I absolutely love from them, Wide Fucking Open and Taking Over. But then the rest of their albums I either just like or don't like at all. I don't know. There's something, I love it or hate it. Every single album is different with me. It's I listen to all of them to see if it's hoping that it would be another Wide Fucking Open.
That's kind of what I was trying to say.
I like the Grinding Wheel and the Wings of Fire actually from the Teens actually more than Ironbound. I found it a little bit more aggressive. That was myself anyway. Yeah.
Interesting.
What about you, Julian?
I don't know. First thing I thought of was like Rust in Peace when I heard like the riffing and stuff like that, and the melodies and stuff remind me a lot of like that kind of era of Megadeth. That's kind of what Ironbound made me think of.
Yeah. What about you, Julian?
Yeah, I thought it was like a pretty good comeback for them in terms of like just their sound, because like he said, that kind of blues-based riffing, which, I mean, I guess pretty much all metal is in a way like blues influenced, just the style. But like they kind of had that more like soft tonal riffage that they were doing. But it definitely was like a better comeback, which made me get back into Overkill actually. But I had a lot more records on my mind that kind of I had to rank higher than this particular record. But I am a huge fan of like old Overkill. Like they have a lot of like that rock and roll kind of vibe to them with a lot of the older stuff that I really enjoyed. But Overkill is definitely like close to being on my list for this top 10.
Your reference, you know, that all metal is blues-based, we could have a whole discussion on that one, because I would say not all of it, you know, some of it's classical-based, right? So, but anyway, that's another episode we can chat about.
It is classical.
All right. So then the third of our number fives, this was Leo's War by War. So to be honest, I hadn't heard it of it before. It's 2013, a Ukrainian band. So I listened to it. So the thing here that got me at first was the drum sound was a little hollow in my mind. Like it was, you can tell it wasn't, you know, big studio recording. It seemed hollow for some reason, not quite right. But the songs themselves, I liked. They were, you know, fast thrash the way I like it. It was raw, and the vocals are very similar to Sodom's Angel Ripper. So, you know, that's a thumbs up for me. And the song that actually really stood out for me when I listened to it was a song called Crossfire. So if anybody wants to check them out, I would suggest that's a good song to get into. Have you guys heard of War? No? Okay. All right. Too bad we didn't have Leo to give us a little bit more background. But okay, let's move on then to, let's see, this is back to you, Julian. So this is Coagulating Darkness by Hell Ripper.
Oh man, don't even get me started on this record. Like that, I don't know, I kind of got into Black and Thrash very early on in my, like, I guess my years of listening to metal, because my first ever show was like seeing Toxic Holocaust play with Black Dahlia Murder in Augusta. But that, like, they do Black and Thrash like so well, because it's not just like straight up like thrash with like black metal style vocals. Like a lot of the riffing like kind of entails like just black metal riffing, like the kind of dissonant chords and stuff like that. Like they do a lot of the speed well. And then I will say, like, their newest record was probably my favorite record that they've done so far. But this particular record, like The Conduit Is Closing, like songs like that just kind of blew me away with the style of riffing. Like it kind of made me want to write riffs that are a bit more just chaotic, I guess, kind of like how he does in that band, because it is like a one-man band, kind of like Toxic Holocaust. So he writes all the riffs on his own and does everything like that, which also is like a very admirable thing to me. So seeing like a record that came out in the 2010s that someone did on their own, and they did it so well with such a great production, I thought was amazing. So this definitely had to be on my top 10 list.
Yeah, I always put Hell Ripper in the Black Speed category rather than Black Thrash, but it's such a freaking fine line, right? I should have worn my Hell Ripper shirt. Yeah, I love that album too. That was one of my faves from, I guess, 2017, looking at my notes here.
Yeah, I've got my
Leo Hell Ripper here. We've got his symbol here, but we're trying to get him in.
Hello, I'm in. Sorry for my miscalculations. I thought we were starting 2 hours after this time. So sorry for little mistakes.
Hey, no problem, Leo. I'm glad you can join us. We've got your audio, but we don't have your video.
I'm unfortunately not at home. I'm in the middle of town, so I couldn't really have my video over here.
Okay. All right. Well, we just went over, let's talk about a couple of your albums then to catch up. So your number three album, just a second. Let me get back. Havoc, Time Is Up was your number three album. We've talked about that already, but what's your take on that album?
This album is a really perfect example of new wave of thrash metal. Basically, it takes all of the advantages of the new scene of thrash metal and mixes it up with the atmosphere and the energy of old school sound. And basically, they got a lot of double kick bass stuff. They got a lot of melodic stuff. They got a lot of headbanging stuff. And all of that is perfectly combined together. And that album just gets you from the first song to the last song. It got no fillers. So that's just an amazing solid thrash record, and one of the best in their discography, and no fillers, all killers, just like said. So that's what I got to say.
Okay. The other one we've talked about already was Vector Terminal Redux. So you want to chime in there for some feedback on that one?
Well, this album is a full journey from the beginning to an end. It's an hour-long album, and it doesn't make you boring through the time you listen to it. All of those songs are complex, are amazing. They got some vibrant influences and also some prog rock influences, but not laying off the brutality side, which is really interesting. It got that space atmosphere that delivers you through all the album, and amazing instrumentals, amazing vocals. Every instrument which is present in that album sounds great, sounds amazing, and that's when I heard that album, it fully blew me away and kind of introduced me to the new side of thrash metal and opened my musical horizons.
Yeah, I think. Well, you and I had picked that one together there. And in fact, there's only two albums that we had that the group of us had overlap in, and that was one of them. So the last one to keep bring you up to speed then, Leo, we talked about War. None of us had heard of this band before. I took a chance, took a listen to this before the episode and gave my feedback. But why don't you give us a little bit more info about the band? You know, they're out of the Ukraine, but we don't know much more about that.
These bands are close friends. They're a black thrash metal band, which has influences of Venom, Motorhead, Carnivore, early Sodom, and they carry that black thrash speed atmosphere. And they're just basically playing rock and roll. They have recorded their debut album, War. EP called Victory. They have a split with the band called Inabios in 2019, I guess. They have a lot of great songs right here, and right now they're preparing their new studio album. I heard pieces of it. This is just amazing, and they're still progressing and making their music a little bit more complex. Also, they have influences of Russian thrash metal band called Corrosion of Metal, and they have kind of that anthemic vibe to it. Amazing, short, simple songs which everyone in the hall could simply sing along to. For example, this is the closing track of the album called Heavy Rock, and this is just a crazy hit which everyone is moshing to, everyone is singing along to in our underground circles. So I got to include that album because it's a full-blown hit. And also an interesting fact about it, that it was recorded live. It was a live session on the rehearsal space.
Interesting. Yeah, I definitely heard the Sodom influence there for sure. Okay, so let's continue on. We're into our number fives now, Leo, just to bring you up to speed. So the last of our ties at number five is mine. So we've been talking about black thrash. We're going to talk a little bit more about black thrash. That's the stuff I like anyway. So it's Wildfire by Destroyer 666. So this is their fifth album, their latest album. So what stands out for me about this one is how well it's produced. That all the different instruments are really clearly discernible. And usually that, to me, I don't necessarily like in thrash because it tends to get in the way of the power. But here, it for some reason, it works for me. And especially there's a second guitar that's always weaving in and out underneath playing different riffs, which really intrigued me. I thought that was a little bit different from most of the rest of the bands out there. Great sneering vocals, just a great example of punishing black thrash. So the song I would point to for people to try out is the opener, Traitor, which is just frickin' face-melting stuff. Does anybody have any insight into Destroyer 666?
Yeah, I've actually got this record on vinyl.
You're on mute there, Julian.
Sorry about that. I thought it unmuted. yeah, I've got this record on vinyl. It's one of my favorite ones by Destroyer 666. Every track on there is, it's like a nice, like, culmination of black thrash, like in that whole subgenre. White Line Fever is one song that I really enjoyed. They're all like really raw songs, but they're also like produced really well, I think, you know, which is, it's hard to kind of find that in a lot of black thrash. So I would definitely recommend like this record to anybody if they're wanting to get into that genre.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, I wish I knew this album. I only know the, I'm looking it up. I forgot the name of the album I love by them. It's earlier than that. Phoenix Rising. That's the album I love by them. I haven't really kept up with them. I'm going to have to check it out.
Yeah, it's a good one. A goodie, for sure. Okay, so then we have three albums that tied at number two with scores of 10. So these are three albums that three different individuals picked as their number ones. So the first one, we're going to go back to you, Leo. It's Global Degeneration by Rehabilitator.
Offers.
So Leo, we'll come back to you in a second and we'll move forward.
Can you still hear me? Hello.
Yeah, we got you.
This record offers an interesting flavor of thrash with a little bit of Brazilian influences. Some people compare it to Violator, but I see quite slight differences between these bands. There's a lot of bass soloing, a lot of melodic solos in the guitar, and the production. Production is very raw. It's really delivers that old school atmosphere. It got a lot of rememberable, even catchy, not in the bad meaning of that word, songs. They're pure amazing. For example, Wall of Death. It also gets our crowds to insanely moshing, insanely banging their fucking heads, because this is a real one banger. A lot of great songs like Chernobyl, Self-Extinction of Mankind, Global Degeneration, all of them are really great. And the drumming also, their drummer is the vocalist. So that way, what makes this band really unique when you watch them perform live. And this is really an amazing experience when you see the singing drummer, especially with those drum parts, because he's really a good drummer and really a good vocalist. Those high-pitched screaming vocals really fit all those raw riffs that sometimes meet the punky atmosphere, and this is just a great record. Great record to mosh to headbang, just to enjoy your life and basically understand what thrash is in nowadays.
Yeah, I listened to it as well, and the thing that jumped out at me was the bass. Yeah, the bass work was really, really good there, and you know, lots of intricate shit going on underneath, and yeah, that was cool with me. And the riffing was quite good too. Yeah. Have you guys heard of Rehabilitator? No? Okay. All right, so let's go to the other two number twos. So we're back to you, Mark and Ian, for The Raging Tides by Exhumer.
All right, Exhumer is one of my favorites. You know, in 1986, a lot of good thrash came out. You know, you have Puppets, Rain and Blood, I think Peace Sells, Darkness Descends. But criminally overlooked is the German band Exhumer. They put out Possessed by Fire, freaking awesome album. Unfortunately, their second album, they got rid of their singer, who's the man, M.V. Stein. And then I think when they reformed in like 2000, maybe 2010 or 12 or something like that, he got back in the band. But this is one of their albums from that decade. I think it's 2014, I'm not sure. But I love this album. It's in the way, it's the opposite of what we were talking about before. There are no elements of like other genres. There's no like, you know, out of place, like hardcore breakdowns. There's no overwhelmingly, you know, like death metal or black metal influences. This is straight thrash metal, which is just an achievement in itself, in my opinion, in the decade. I think M.V. Stein's vocals are, just sounds like a demon here. I guess it's a matter of taste. Some people, it's kind of like a Dave Mustaine thing where some people love the vocals. Some people aren't a fan of it. I think it rips. For a song recommendation, let me see here. You know what? Title track, opener, Raging Tides, just absolutely rips. And it's a good album because what I like about an album sometimes is the pacing, even when you love an album, but it's even if you love thrash, you love heavy metal. After a row, when it's just five or six songs at the same, you know, blistering tempo, you kind of want some breath, and they do that here and there. They have like these like slower, you know, kind of, you know, 80s chugging for like a thrash breakdown, and then it gets right back into it. So, you know, you thought you want to chime in on Exhumer, man?
No, not particularly.
Anybody else want to know this one? Or?
I mean, like, I enjoyed listening to the album, but nothing really stood out for me. I mean, as compared to like the classic stuff, you know, that they put out, it's just actually there was one thing that I did think of was like some of the lyrics were kind of like really cheesy in a sense. Like there's one part where it's like sticks and stones break my bones, and just like I was like, man, it's supposed to be like a thrash metal. Oh my god, and why am I here? It's like a you know a high school kid nursery rhyme or something like that. You know, something you hear on the playground.
Well, when I think of these guys, I think of you know, Americanized thrash from Germany, and I like the German form more than the American form. So, you know, I'm the same way. It sounds good, but to me, it's just too much in the pocket. It's not wild enough. I like some, you know, crazy.
Yeah, that's a great way to put it, though. It is very in the pocket. It's extremely tight. Everything is synced up. So, yeah.
I feel like a lot of these bands are like that, especially like the more popular bands. Like you were talking about Creator, we were talking about Overkill. Like everything is so tight. It's so overproduced. You know, it doesn't have that rawness. It's almost like sterile in a sense where like, and it's not that the musicianship is not good or the songwriting is not good. It's just, like you said, thrash needs that raw energy to it and that kind of chaos. And I feel like this too, it's way too tight to be a thrash band.
Yeah. Anybody else want to chime in on that?
I will say, like, I really did enjoy the covers that they actually did on the record. They did a Grip Inc. cover, which was really good. I can't remember the name of the song off the top of my head, but it was like, for being a thrash band, doing something that was a little bit more, I guess, technical, kind of like Grip Inc. was, like that weird, just out of pocket kind of thing, is like, that's the one out of pocket thing I would say that's on the record, is like them doing that. You know, they definitely do have that refined kind of sound, which I do enjoy a lot of the songs. Like Sacred Defense is probably one of my favorites off that record, but I will say I really enjoyed the covers, because like they did a pentagram cover, I believe, on that
record. Yeah, they did a pentagram on the I think it's one of the last songs. Yeah.
I'm a huge Grip Inc. guy, and I didn't catch that. Then I'm gonna have to go back and listen to that. Anyway,
yeah, definitely.
All right. So the last of our number twos is my favorite album of the 2010s. It's Assassinos Omsere by Toxic Attack. So this is one where I think a lot of people are going to go, who the fuck is that? And the ones who have
heard I want to know. I'm curious now.
The other ones who have heard are going to say, what the hell are you thinking? The reason why is that the vocals here are controversial. And that the guy, there's nobody that sounds like this guy. His name is Nico666. So he sings, he yelps, he growls, he jumps all over the place. And at times he sounds like an ape being anally probed. It's really like amazing, you know, how he flips between all these voices, right? Amazing. Most people, you know, don't like it. But to me, when you put that on top of what I think is the best thrash riffs of the decade, like we're talking high speed all the time, energy out the wazoo from beginning to end, and then this guy yelping over top, totally unique. Nobody sounds like these guys. Loved it. Easily my number one album of the decade. Just amazing. So if you try it out, you're probably going to either love it or hate it.
Can you say it again, Chris? Can you say the name of the album again?
It's Assassinos Omsere by the band called Toxic Attack.
So where are they from?
They're from Portugal.
Okay, cool. Yeah, check it out.
It's their debut. Yeah.
Yeah.
So the song to try out would be Thrash Meldicchio. That's how he says it. Anyway. Okay, so now we're down to the number one album. So obviously the other album that had two picks to it. Julian, it's your number one. And Ian and Mark, it was your number five, I think. It's Nightmare Logic by Power Trip.
This record probably has the most, I guess, resonance as far as like thrash is for the 2010s, because I loved their first full length, Manifest Decimation. But I will say the production on that record was a lot, like, it was very thin. Like the vocals were over reverbed, and like the drums kind of sounded a little bit hollow. But they stepped up their game with this record. Like every song, all the riffs were so memorable. I mean, of course, you've got Executioner's Tax. Everybody knows that. You've got Condition. There's so many songs, like Firing Squad, of course, like that. Everyone just goes fucking crazy during that song. Like all the riffage in this record was like well thought out. Like they wrote this song to be, or not this song, this record to be not only like a very good thrash record, but also accessible. Like people that don't like thrash or don't like metal will come to this record and be like, okay, you know, I can understand why people like this, and they'll get into it. Which, I mean, I'm wearing a Gate Creeper shirt. They're kind of the same way, like as far as death metal, but for Power Trip, like every song on this record, you know, I can't say anything bad about. Like, you know, the production skyrocketed on this. Like everything's so much better. And like hearing that single they put out, Hornet's Nest 2, like it made me super excited, which it was a shame, you know, hearing about Riley passing last year. But as far as I'm aware, like seeing social media and stuff, I think they're thinking about continuing the band. So I'm looking forward to it. I just don't know how it's going to be without Riley, because his vocal style was really something that I modeled my own vocal style actually after. I do like a little bit of a mix of like trying to do black and stuff, but also like that kind of hardcore like shouting that he does. Like I really enjoyed his vocals on there, so this had to be my number one record on here.
What about you, Mark?
Yeah, I think Julian described it really well. You know, Power Trip this album is a really good album, for more reasons than you might think. For example, he pointed out that it's accessible. For like diehard people who are like crazy into thrash, like this might not seem like the most groundbreaking album, but this is very accessible in the sense that, like, you know, from being from New York, there's not really a big thrash or even a heavy metal scene, or at least where we're at. But hardcore is huge, and I can tell you there's, you know, like 10 plus kids I know who are into hardcore, obsessed with hardcore. They think metal is shit, and Power Trip is like their gateway drug into thrash. So that alone, I mean, we're not talking 1994 here. This is, you know, the 2010s. That's huge for like there to be one singular album that's funneling people into the genre. You know, my wife loves metal, and she likes, well, people at work, oh yeah, like I listen to Ozzy Osbourne, you know, that like they're, you know, very casual metal. And I listen to, you know, Executioner's Tax, and they're like, wow, this is a cool song. I want to see this band. So for that, I think it should be on the list. The vocals, yeah, Riley, obviously, he passed away, like, last year or 2 years. Heavy reverb mixed with, like, just a very violent, aggressive way of singing gives this album, like, really a bigger feel than it is. It is very, I don't know if riffy is the right word, but they're obviously trying to go for these, like, kind of old-school 80s, like, crossover breakdowns, but also, like, a hardcore element. So it's very, I think it's accessible for us. It's designed to be catchy. The songs are designed to have hooks. The solos, that's as a guitar player, that's my thing with this album, is that the solos are too much of the kind of like the Slayer whammy bar to give it ambiance, and there's not really this fucking wild frenetic energy that I think, Chris, it seems like you like. Mm-hmm. But it's on my list for that reason. It's they really did cross over in that sense. Like if they had another album, you know, it's sad to say, Riley, I think this band would have blown up like insanely, because I'll see 16-year-old kids with long hair and they're wearing Power Trip shirts, and they have never heard of Iron Maiden. They've never heard of, you know, even Slayer. They don't know. And it's like Power Trip is their band. So, you know, I think that gets them on the list for me, you know?
Yeah, I agree from the, you know, as you say, the gateway band into thrash for sure. When I listened to them, I kept on thinking of Sepultura, early 80s Sepultura for some reason as well when I keep hearing it. So what about you, Leo? What's your take on Power Trip?
Unfortunately, I haven't listened to that record too much. I listened to it only a couple of times. All I can say that this is a great thrash record. I really enjoyed it. Rest in peace to Riley Gale. That really sucks to see young thrash musicians giving hope to us all.
All right.
Really solid. I really enjoyed it. Really amazing record to just sit back in your chair, relax, have a beer, and bang your fucking head.
Yeah, it definitely is not meaning as an insult, but it's kind of more like you can be a mindless metalhead if you want to just bang your head, because it's not, you know, super deep. But I got the pleasure to see them live a few times, and I saw them open up for the Misfits, the original Misfits. Venom was on that bill. I saw them open up for Danzig. I saw them open up for High on Fire and Gate Creeper, and the fucking place goes crazy. It went crazy every time, no matter if it was, you know, old punk heads, metal heads, hardcore kids. Every show I saw them play on, they blew everyone away in the reaction that they got. So,
well, I think you know, like you said, that it's kind of the gateway between the hardcore to thrash metal. I mean, if you listen to it, especially with the drumming,
yeah, that's a good point.
It's almost like DB, like something like Discharge or something like that. It has that specific drum beat that you would be used to listening to in hardcore, so it kind of hooks you really quickly when you're like, oh wow, this is thrash metal, and then again, it's going to be progressive, you know, as more you listen to different bands. But that's what, for me at least, when I listened to it, I felt that was the real strong point, was that DB style of drumming is what makes that bridge.
Yeah,
not even the riffing, because then you do the riffing and then you put the vocals on top of it, you know. It's really, that's what the hook is.
Yeah, I think Ian, actually, I forgot about that. A great point to bring up about that record is there's no double bass. And even live, the guy played
this. I didn't like there was no double bass.
Well, right.
It's still great. Yeah. It's old school punk hardcore.
Right. That's the good point. It's one bass pedal. I'm pretty sure it's one bass. There's no double bass on the whole album, I'm pretty sure, which gives it that accessible, it's not over the top craziness. If you know you're trying to show your
slight dotted half note kind of kick to it, you know, like instead of just like Slayer was like doop doop doop, it's like doop doop doop, it's like that bounce to it, right?
I think it gives it that more accessibility, you know, it gives it that catchiness, I guess you'd say.
So I'm glad Ian joined us. We have too many vocalist guitarists. We need a drummer here. Maybe next time we got to bring in one of your bassists too.
Man, our bass. You don't want to meet our bass.
Yeah, no,
just kidding.
You don't want bass. Yeah, our bass player is farming potatoes right now in North Dakota.
All right, so before we give each of the bands, band members here to give us an update on what's going on with each of their bands. So, Mark and Ian, why don't you give us an update on Electrocutioner?
All right, so we got the cassettes, Chris. Looks like you got some room in the back behind you. No, I'm just kidding.
All right.
So you can get it on our...
I got vinyl, too. Well, vinyl's later.
But... Yeah, vinyl's there. Yeah, give me your address, Chris. We'll send you one. But yeah, we got our cassettes out on Bandcamp. Vinyls are in a few months. Tons of shows are lined up. I was telling Julian, we have Jersey, New Jersey tomorrow. Then we have Kentucky, Pennsylvania, and a few spots in New York coming up. And then we're just, you know, actually, we're going to practice right after this, and then I think in probably like January, February, we're going to try to start recording a full length or something like that, and then hopefully...
Oh, what about the show with...
I can't announce it yet. Yeah, so yeah, cool show coming up.
Yeah, we got a secret.
So then hopefully in the winter, start recording, and spring, summer, launch a new thing and keep it going. So
yeah, we already got...
check it out.
We got about like 3 songs written already. Yeah. We have like a short one, and we're going to use an intro, so almost 4.
So...
But, you know, it's all about keeping that intensity, right? Like, even as you progress as a band and you want to think like, okay, you don't want to be progressive, but you want to kind of evolve, right? In the sense of like songwriting, maybe a little more complex, but then what are you risking, right? You're having the raw intensity and the realness of it versus the progressiveness. So like the more technical you get, a lot of times you lose that. So, I mean, for me at least, I don't think about it. I just let it happen. You know, like, he'll play something and I'll react to it. Like, almost like jazz, you know, like a musician would do. And I feel like that's what you have to do. You have to have that raw spirit, that raw approach to it. You can't be like, I'm going to do this chord progression and then we're going to write it like this and do it. No, you have to just feel it, do it, be real, you know?
So I'll be writing.
We are.
All right. Sounds good. What about you, you Leo? What's going on in the world of Karabiner?
In the next month or two, we're going to record our new single. It's going to be a really long song, and it's delivers different flavors, flavors of thrash. It has some death thrash elements. It also has a few elements of technical thrash, but it doesn't seem off place. It really sounds good in the composition of the song overall. After that, we're gonna make, I guess, an online show with our friends from the local bands. We had our organized local thrash death festival called Bloody Hell Thrash, and basically we're gonna repeat this in the format of online with almost the same lineup of bands. So after that, I think we're gonna have a lot of local shows. Probably in the next year, we're gonna try to have some abroad shows, maybe a little tour. And in this winter, I think we're gonna start recording our full-length album. We have a lot of material for it. Right now it's like 40 minutes of material, but we still have songs that we are working on, and this is going to be a really long record, which will have a lot of different spices of thrash, and this is going to be an interesting one. We're taking from Sodom here, that is brutal, almost death metal songs. They have slow and groovy ones. They have rock and roll kind of Motorhead-ish songs, and that really inspires us up. So that's, I think, what is the conception is going to be.
Excellent. Excellent. So lastly there, Julian with Krypt, what's going on?
Yeah, so since the last time we talked for the 90s, top 10, we actually got signed to Terminus Hate City Records out of Atlanta. So with them, we are planning on recording a full-length record. It'll be our debut full-length. I'm thinking we're wanting to do like 10 songs, and we're hoping to get in there by December. The latest would probably be March. But with that going on, we've also got some stuff set up with setting up a tour, so we're hopefully doing like it, starting off weekenders, and then we'll probably do like a little over a week long tour as well with our buddies in Never Falls, another southern thrash band, and we're looking to get some festivals set up, so we're talking to the label about that as well. So shout out to Jay Crash for signing us and setting everything up. We're also supposed to, we got offered to play with Raven, which was something that I thought was awesome, but unfortunately, like, you know, our bass player's busy farming for wrap snacks in North Dakota right now. He should be back at the end of this month, though. So after that, we're going to be booking shows, and then we're going to go from there. We're getting our debut EP that we put out, Enter the Krypt. We're going to get that pressed out on vinyl and get some cassettes done as well, especially now that we have label backing. And we're hoping to do the same for the new record. We've got, I want to say, 7 songs already done for the new record, so we just have to do 3 more and we should be good. You know, give it a little bit of time to kind of refine everything. You'll probably see a little bit of a change in the sound, slightly from some of the songwriting perspective. Like, it's not just like crazy fast for everything, you know, like it's got a little bit of a there. You'll see like 1 or 2 maybe mid-tempo songs on there that are still like just pounding and raw, which I hope everybody enjoys. But yeah, we've got some new merch designs coming out as well, so we're looking forward to that. And you know, hopefully we can play with some of you guys in the future as well. Like, I'd love to go to Ukraine and New York and everything, you know, like just play everywhere and bring thrash to everybody, you know, and bring you guys out. Well.
Come up to Canada too for Chris, right?
I can't play an instrument. Yeah, I'll sing along. Yeah, well, thanks guys for helping out on this episode. It was a lot of fun as usual. I'm thinking 80s thrash should be our next one, the biggie, right? So
yeah,
are we putting
I think Leo was
all right. Yeah, guys, Leo.
Yeah, you're okay with that, Leo?
Yeah, I think that's it's a perfect idea.
All right.
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah, all definitely. Right.
And keep me apprised of what's going on, guys, because I'll post it up on our website too. There's and send out the links to whatever's going on with your bands, right? So everybody, thanks again for watching, listening, whether you're on YouTube or on SoundScan or SoundCloud or wherever you are. We'll catch you later. In the meantime, check out our website www.themightydecibel.com for all your metal needs. Have a great one. Bye.
Thanks, man. Peace.
Thank you.
Hey, thanks, guys.
Goodbye. Thanks, yeah. Everyone.
Thank you for having me.